This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world. A familiar and very popular guest is with us on Dreamland again. I want to welcome Joshua Kutchin back. Joshua has been on Dreamland many times, most recently last October, where we discussed Volume 1 of Ecology of Souls, A New Mythology of Death and the Paranormal. Now we're on Volume 2, and why do you need to listen to this again? Because we're going down a completely new path here. Joshua has made some major breakthroughs, which we began to see in Volume 1, but now in Volume 2, we're going to be talking about things like the ufology and the overworld. We're going to be talking about alien abductions in a completely new way. What do they have to do with the dead? And what about NDEs and people having abductions in the context of NDEs? I mean, wow, this is deep, incredible stuff. So let's get started. Kutch, I would like to welcome you back to Dreamland. Good to have you again.
It's an absolute pleasure to be here, speaking with someone who I think, I mean, in a lot of ways, you obviously, Ann, were inspiration for this work. So it's an absolute privilege.
Well, I'm so glad that I was an inspiration for something besides a bill collector.
You'd be surprised. You'd be surprised.
So, Joshua, tell us a little bit about your background, will you? Because you're a remarkable man in many, many respects. I mean, you don't have to be modest, but you probably will be. But just tell us what your scholarly background is, for example.
Well, the thumbnail sketch, I guess, without treading too much familiar ground to people who have heard me before, is that I grew up in a household that was very open to a lot of different things. And reading and looking into these sort of fringe subjects was never frowned upon. As far as the sort of genesis of my scholarly background for this, I do have two master's degrees. So I guess if you get through that process alive, you wind up having a bit of an affinity for sources and citations and endnotes. I have a master's in music and a master's in journalism. Of course, you know, the ironic thing is that once I got out into the real world, I'm like, I'm not really sure I want to do either of these things. So I continue to play music. I don't play as much classical music as I used to. I guess I'm one of the few tuba players who's played in Carnegie Hall and Green Hall in Texas, two very different venues. But I still continue to play music quite a bit. We're coming up on Mardi Gras here, so it's going to be one of my busiest times of year. I am a classically trained tuba player. But I really do think that, especially my time in journalism school, has proven essential for a lot of the work that I'm doing now. I think there is a significant problem in a lot of the writing about these topics where people will say, I heard a story, and, you know, they'll just sort of rattle on without saying where it came from. And, you know, so that's one of the main reasons that I try to bring so much documentation to the table. Not to say that every case that I talk about is vetted, to the contrary, there's some things in here where, you know, I don't know, but at the end of the day, the reader can track down where I read it and sort of decide for themselves. So it's also a form of insurance in a way as well.
Yeah, I understand that very well. And I might comment in passing that I've been in Green Hall and Carnegie Hall too. And Green Hall is a wonderful place. I think I square danced in Green Hall.
Now the floorboards still sort of, they move when you walk on them.
Oh yeah, I've been, yeah, definitely. It's a long time ago, but that's a lovely, fun place. And of course, Carnegie Hall, the best acoustics in America, in my opinion. That's fantastic. So for classical music. All right, now we're haunted. We're haunted by something. We've been haunted by it for a long time. But am I right in thinking that it has really ramped up over the past, say, 60 or 70 years? Is there a lot more going on now than there was, say, in 100 AD or 1000 BC? Or is it just that we're more in communication with each other.
I would probably push back to a degree on that assumption in a way, because I think that it's not that we are necessarily more communicative or that these things have ramped up. I suspect, and of course I'm very willing to be proven wrong, but I suspect that it has more to do with the fact that we view these things as outliers now in our modern society. Whereas at one point they were just sort of folded in and incorporated into just the tapestry of day-to-day life. And now when these things still happen, it's like, well, that's not the way we were told things were supposed to be. So that would be one thing that I suspect. If there is a bit of an uptick, I think that it might be a response to a degree, in a response specifically to the way that we have pushed these things out. And just as, you know, the tide rolls out, the tide's got to roll back in. And I think maybe these things have rolled back in into the margins of modernity as we've gone further and further.
Free Dreamlanders, I've got good news and bad news. The good news is we'll be back. And the bad news is what you're going to see right now. Where is the unknown country? Is it out there in the stars? Or is it also somewhere else? Is it in us, in you? Unknown country, join us today. Go to unknowncountry.com right now and join us. Join the questions. Join the search. Join the adventure. Unknowncountry.com. There's no place like it in the world. We're talking to Joshua Cutchin. His book, Ecology of Souls, a huge compendium and an extraordinary achievement. Volume 2, A New Mythology of Death and the Paranormal. And it is truly, truly new. Joshua, where can we reach you online, on the internet?
Well, joshuacutchin.com, and I'm going to spell that out because I've been to enough restaurants where the dinner reservation has been mispronounced, so I'll go ahead and spell it out, joshuacutchin.com. No S, just like one cut on your chin. joshuacutchin.com is where I try to keep a thorough record of everywhere I am and what I'm doing. There's contact links there. There's also links to all the interviews that I do, as well as past appearances as well. So that's your one-stop shop.
Okay. joshuacutchin.com. Now, I knew that. And why didn't I just say it? Because they're listening to you. And they will come to your website if they hear it from you. I've learned this from long, long experience. Now, let's explore a little bit of the whole alien abduction phenomenon in a slightly different way. Now, one of the things that you talk about are spirit precursors to abductions. Could you explain to us what you mean and what happens when an abduction finally follows?
Well, this sort of ties into a stigma that you used to find in ufology a long time ago, the stigma of the repeater. There was a time, as I'm sure you're aware, where if anyone saw multiple strange things, a lot of the ufologists would say, oh, you're a repeater, which was basically shorthand for saying you've had too much strange stuff happen. You're obviously lying. And I think your life is certainly a testimony to the fact that people can be truthful and be repeaters. Like, it's so there's been an interesting tide, so an interesting sea change that has happened in the interim, where nowadays I would suspect that being a repeater actually lends more credence to someone's story in a lot of regards, because these things do tend, in my experience, tend to, not as a hard and fast rule, they tend to center around an individual. Now, with that comes perhaps one of the most confounding problems that I pretty much wrote about in the book, and I still don't know where I land on it, which is the problem that I call the chicken and the egg problem, which is, in ufology specifically, do people have strange encounters prior to their first contact experience with UFOs, or do UFOs and UFO contact open up and a sort of affinity for having these strange encounters? I'm not really sure. I thought that maybe I'd go in and I would find that, oh, people who grew up in haunted houses are more likely to have UFO contact later in life. Or I might find the opposite. And really, it just seems split pretty much down the middle, to be quite honest with you. There are some people who have a near-death experience and then see UFOs regularly afterwards. There are people who see UFOs first and then have a near-death experience. And both those things, and even if you want to throw haunted houses into the mix, all three of those things are things that most of us don't experience. Most of us don't experience at once, and you know, very few of us experience these things multiple times like so many experiencers do. So it does beg the question of why these individuals have so much contact of all sorts of different varieties, the sort of contact that we used to silo off into separate disciplines. You know, the ghosts are over here and your, you know, your religious phenomena are over here and your UFOs are over here. It just seems to really mix and match and jumble in the lives of a lot of experiencers.
There's a new world coming if we can take it. What does that mean? The first part of the message is, if we can take it for ourselves on our own terms. The second part of the message is, can we bear the newness and the huge expansion of human consciousness that is going to be involved? Can we take it? A new world. It doesn't mince words. It tells the good, the bad, and the ugly like it is, and it leaves a message behind. Can you do this? Do you want to? Do we have an alternative? Right now, at this point in history, mankind is either going to get a lot bigger or not. I choose to go forward. I choose to live for and in the future. I choose the future. A new world. We can take it. Available in hardcover, softcover, audiobook, and Kindle.
So we have this mixing and matching, though. I'll give you an example from your book. The Weiner case, the Allagash abduction, you mm-hmm. mentioned that they had these two, you'll tell us about the abduction in a minute, and then these two people as children had visions of ghosts which sat on their beds, sometimes pressing down on it as they visited. Now, the last awareness of that happened to me this morning at about 3 o'clock. I often have something pressed down on my legs in the very early hours of the morning, especially if I have not gotten up for my 3 a.m. meditation. I mean, I've had all kinds of ways of being waked up, some of them terrifying, most of them either startling or in some cases like that, very nice, because it's a very pleasant sensation. There's a definite weight. There is a vibration between my legs and whatever is there. I can't see it. It's always well enough below my hands so I can't grab it. They're taking no chances, whoever they are. But what is this? Because ghosts that press down on a bed, are those ghosts or what are they, Joshua? What do you think?
Well, I hate to be a bit of a fence sitter, but I'm not even sure I know what ghosts are. I mean, there's this.
Well, give us some riff, will you?
Okay. I'll riff. Well, you know, I think that as much as we like to talk about the extraterrestrial hypothesis having sort of a stranglehold on discussion of UFOs, I've never heard it referred to as this, but the DPH, the dead people hypothesis, has an even tighter stranglehold on you know, parapsychology and a lot of ghost aficionados. And I'm certainly sympathetic to that because there are cases that seem to behave that way. But at the same time, you'll find all sorts of things that seem to run contrary to that. One example that I love to use, being a North Carolina native, is that people claim to see George Vanderbilt at Biltmore Estate in Asheville, and they'll see him with a cigar and a brandy. And Vanderbilt was a teetotaler, supposedly. Now, I don't know if he was sneaking things on the side and he likes to do that in the afterlife, but it does open up the question to people's expectations perhaps playing a role in the way that they see these things. Then you have other cases like the ghost of Mark Twain, for example, which is said to haunt several different locations, if memory serves. So, you know, I'm not discounting the idea that our souls could fracture or that there are multiple parts of us. I mean, to the contrary, a great amount of space in this book, Ecology of Souls, is dedicated to talking about the idea of polypsychism, that we have multiple souls within us. But at the same time, some of these hauntings seem to run counter to the idea that we're strictly dealing with ghosts. There's another wonderful theory that I've always been sympathetic to, which is the stone tape theory, not to be confused with Terence McKenna's stoned ape theory, but the stone tape theory, which holds that certain materials in the environment, perhaps minerals and rock deposits and whatnot, somehow record certain emotions, certain energies, and play them back under certain circumstances, which we have yet to determine. And there's some evidence that this perhaps could be what's going on in some instances, especially when you're dealing with a ghost who simply walks past someone and never acknowledges them. Now, when you get spirits that seem to acknowledge the witness, then you're probably dealing with something a little bit different. But if it's just a replay, then maybe something like that's going on. So, you know, and this is not even starting to address the possibility that some ghosts might literally be a psychic projection of the witness themselves, which I think is extremely possible. And who knows, maybe that's the case with your alarm clock system that you have going on at 3 a.m.
Yeah, it could be the case. Certainly the 3 a.m. meditation has become such a part of my life and so wanted. I'm always grateful when I'm waked up, and I have never used an alarm on purpose because I want this engagement. I want there to be engagement between me and whatever this is. And I don't really know why it wants these 3 a.m. wake up calls. I do know that I think about my work very deeply at that hour, and that's a hour that's known to be a time that's particularly good for that kind of thought. And certain traditions, yoga traditions, it's expected that people will wake up at approximately an hour and a half before dawn for that reason. Let's now talk about this. We're trying to stay on the kind of shadow line between the dead and poltergeists and ghosts and the kind of physical phenomenon, because there's something to be found here, and we're going to try to find it today. But for free dreamlanders, you've got to find something else first. We'll be right back.
Did we misunderstand the teaching of Jesus? Perhaps a long time ago, perhaps almost as soon as he rose from the dead, we mistook him for something that he may not have been. But we do know one thing: he was one of us. His life and his resurrection reveal the power of the good in all of us, and his teaching shows anybody, whether they have religious beliefs or not, how to find that goodness and live it. Get Jesus a New Vision. It's available as an audio book. It is available as a paperback and as a Kindle. Get it today.
We're talking to Joshua Cutchin. His website, joshuacutchin.com. That's Joshua as in tree, and Cutchin, C-U-T-C-H-I-N. And if you don't know what Joshua as in tree means, go to out to the desert here in California. It's called Joshua Tree. So joshuacutchin.com, his new book, Ecology of Souls. And we're exploring this relationship between physical stuff and non-physical stuff. Aliens, maybe, and the dead, for sure. Okay, here's many stories in here that of. Let's go to this one of Karen that really struck me. Here she is, a life filled with ghosts and poltergeists. You remember the story?
I do. Yeah. She was. Okay.
Then what happens?
Well, she was from Cheshire, and she grew up with a lot of just strange things. I suppose that you would say that she was a sensitive. But things really came to a head for her from a ufological perspective in the summer of 1979. And Karen was walking past a meadow, I believe, and she saw a blinding light that came from the field. And she was actually, she actually became pregnant some short time after this, and she started having these dreams of basically birthing horrific children, as gruesome as that sounds. And tragically, she had a miscarriage from this particular pregnancy. And she came to believe that the dreams were actually predicting that. 5 years after this, so this would have been about 1984, she saw the same light from her window. And according to her story, a woman who was basically she had white skin and she had slanted eyes, and she was about 6 feet tall, appeared in the doorway, backlit by this light. And the last thing that she remembered, Karen remembered, was that there was this intense feeling of cold that enveloped her. And, you know, then she woke up in bed, as tends to happen in these encounters sometimes. Months later, she was awoken by the feeling of a children's fingers, a little child's fingers on her wrist, and they sort of tugged her awake. And according to the story, as collected by Jenny Randalls, her husband came into the room and flicked on a light. And as they did, they noticed a tiny orb of light that sort of floated up and disappeared through the ceiling. So, you know, if you take out the entity with the slanted eyes, and you take out some of these flashes to a certain degree, a lot of people would just refer to this as a quite touching ghost story. But then you get this sort of other layer that seems to resonate a bit more with the UFO stuff, and it leaves everybody wondering exactly what we're dealing with here.
That's putting it mildly, because, you know, this is an important show for me because it's so important to understand that we live by these shorthands and either ors. Either it's ghosts or it's aliens. Either it's the dead or it's something at demons, for example. Mm-hmm. But those either ors don't actually work.
I resonate with that 100% because one of the things that I'm very fond of saying, as anybody who's followed my work knows, I'm very sympathetic to the observations that Jacques Vallée made between the Western European fairy folk and a lot of the UFO literature. And one of the things that I'm fond of saying is, you know, I'm not saying that aliens are fairies, and I'm not saying that fairies are aliens. I don't necessarily think either of those labels is accurate. You know, to a certain degree, I don't think, as we just discussed, ghosts is an accurate label either. I think these are just all ways for us to try to grasp this completely incomprehensible numinous phenomena that we've been wrestling with forever. I mean, it's very much like the parable of the blind man and the elephant, I think.
Tell us the parable of the blind man and the elephant, just to refresh our memory.
Yeah, so the shorthand is that you have several individuals who have lost their sight, and they come upon an elephant, and one of them, who is at the front end of the elephant, says, "Oh, I can, you know, feel it. I can feel it. It's a snake." And another one who's by its ear says, "Oh, I can feel it. It's a big palm leaf." And another one who's by its feet says, "No, it's not. It's a tree trunk." You know, and et cetera, et cetera. You can keep on doing this sort of little experiment with different ways to interpret it, but they're all feeling different parts of the elephant without realizing that it's actually all those answers are incorrect. They're actually all feeling one thing, which is the elephant. They're just seeing and interacting with different parts with the limitations of their own perception.
Well, that's the key, the limitations of perception, because, well, when you think about it, let's develop the idea of the elephant a little bit. An elephant can hear very low sounds and has a type of vision that is not necessarily keyed to details. A mouse can hear very high sounds and has vision that is not keyed to very large objects, because obviously doesn't need to see those. Put an elephant and a mouse together in a room. The elephant cannot hear or see the mouse. The mouse cannot hear or see the elephant. Now, what in the world does that mean? It means to me that maybe our perceptual systems are not enough to enable us to completely comprehend this whole thing. What do you think of that? I mean, isn't that a possibility?
Well, I absolutely agree with it. And I, you know, something that I was having a conversation with someone else, and once you step back and realize how much of our reality is defined by language, it kind of gets it gets quite terrifying existentially. I mean, the example that I used is, you know, we like to, for example, you take an illness like leukemia, right? We like to think that we have leukemia studied very well. We've put it in a box. We have given it a name. We have a good idea of how it behaves, this, that, and the other. But once you dial it back to like a 10,000 foot view of reality and culture, and you see those names and labels sort of slough themselves off. I mean, leukemia doesn't call itself leukemia. And, you know, all those ideas that we have of how it behaves in certain ways and the things that we can do to treat it, none of those are really hard and fast rules, because we've tried to put something in a box that really never belonged in a box in the first place. And you can, you know, I use that example because I find it quite terrifying when you extrapolate that out to all of, you know, medicine. But you can do this with anything, and you realize that we are just hanging on by the barest of threads to a grasp on the reality that is surrounding us. And we do that a lot of ways with language. And this, you know, you hear these stories, and I don't know if they're true or not, but you hear stories about people contacting certain indigenous tribes and the tribes not words for certain colors or words to distinguish certain colors from other colors. And even if that's not true, it's again, one of those good examples of how language tends to bind and influence the way that we think, because if you don't have a name for something, do you even see it in the first place? So I think that, you know, beyond like, oh, well, maybe these entities are dwelling in a different spectrum of light, or maybe they're, you know, existing in forms of matter that we can't even perceive with our most advanced instruments. Besides all that, you know, even if they were right in front of our faces, I'm not sure if we would understand what they were unless we had a word to put to them.
Yeah, that inability to understand is fundamental, because all we can do, we never see reality. We never do. All we see is what our bodies and brains are generating. That's what our perceptions are always inside us. So we don't really know what's going on out there. For us, there is no out there. That's true of every single living thing. We really genuinely don't know where we are in the most empirical way.
Absolutely. I mean, you know, you think of things like a good example that actually pops up in the book is Fata Morgana, this phenomenon where, you know, ships out at sea appear to be above the horizon. And that's not what's happening. But if we didn't know any better, we'd think that is what's happening. So it's just we are in a more sort of, again, I keep on using this word, existentially terrifying way. We're sort of trapped in these little, our own boxes, the box of our head. And if you remove our senses, we have no way of understanding anything that's around us. So I think it's a very short leap from that to entertaining the idea that there are things that there, you know, we talk about things like radiation and light spectra and all these sort of different things, but there might be some sort of behavior, quality, matter, whatever you want to call it, in the universe that we haven't even discovered yet. And that's where these things reside.
Well, you know, that gets me to a great quote you have in here from Terence McKenna, the great Terence McKenna, so tragically lost to brain cancer, one of the most brilliant men I ever knew, and one of the men I disliked me most intensely and with most skill. His brother doesn't like me much more than he did. But Dennis, but that's neither here nor there. I mean, if you're going to live and do and talk about the things I talk about, you're going to have people who don't like you. And, you know, that's part of my life and I don't mind. And it also doesn't mean because they don't like me that I don't like them or I don't respect their work. That said, Terence McKenna said, and you quote in the book, our soul is so alienated from us in our present culture that we treat it as an extraterrestrial. He says the most alien thing in the cosmos is the human soul. Now, I think those are incredibly profound and resonant statements. And you next go into the hybrid program. And I thought when I was reading this, why does he bring up this split between us and our souls and then go straight into hybrids? But there's a reason for it. Let's first talk about the idea that we no longer know what we are because we have lost contact with our souls. Can you sort of speak to that? Oh, but before you do it, Free Dreamlanders, I've got fabulous news this time, better than ever. The better news this time is this is the last break. We'll be right back.
Have you ever read Communion? Or have you never read Communion? It's out in a new edition. Very powerful, a subtly new cover that reflects the fact that the visitors are now looking back at us. Because they truly are. You can get it from the unknowncountry.com store as a Kindle, as a beautiful, sumptuous paperback, or as an unabridged audiobook read by me. It's the first time in the whole life of Communion that it has been read in full in audio format. And believe you me, I felt that reading. I put my life, my memories, into it, and I trust you can hear it in the voice. I sure felt it while I was reading. So get Communion, listen to it, read it. Communion is of central importance to all of our lives.
UnknownCountry.com. It's huge. It's much more than just a Whitley Strieber book site. It contains thousands of hours of interviews, meditations, podcasts of all kinds. My original hypnosis tapes are there. You can actually hear the moment that I discovered that I, at least, was not alone in this universe, in the office of Dr. Donald Klein so many years ago. Whitley Strieber audiobooks, Communion, Transformation, The Secret School, Breakthrough, Majestic, and so much more. Powerful meditations, but more even than all that, it is a community of people who are either looking to gain contact or actually in contact now. There is no community like it in the world. It is absolutely unique. Contact really is happening here. That's what these shows are all about. That's what my life and this website are about. It's real.
And it can be of enormous benefit to us individually and to mankind as long as we take our part and do it our way. This is what being a member of Unknown Country is about. So go to unknowncountry.com and subscribe today. Join us and join, very frankly, the future.
We're back with Joshua Cutchin. His website, joshuacutchin.com. His new book is Volume 2 of Ecology of Souls. If you read Volume 1, you must not miss Volume 2. And if you didn't read Volume 1, you don't have to start with Volume 1 because Volume 2 is self-contained. And it is what it's filled with are these fabulously interesting stories that of the kind that free you, your mind deeply. That's the wonderful thing about the human ability to tell stories. Stories are literal, real magic. And you will, if you steep yourself in the story magic in this book, you want contact, you're liable to get it. What about you, Kutch? Have you had much contact?
Oh, you could probably fit it all inside a thimble. I've had a couple of rather dramatic ghost experiences, but beyond that, nothing of the ufological variety. I mean, again, we just talked about how we're breaking down barriers between these things, so perhaps that's a bit disingenuous. But the things that I've seen, I saw the ghost of a young Confederate soldier boy in Stonewall Jackson's house, which during the Civil War was used as a hospital. I also had a door slam directly in my face while on a late night ghost hunt at Waverly Hills Sanitarium. That's pretty much what I've had. I've had a couple things that seem kind of Bigfooty, but I haven't seen those two that I just mentioned are the most dramatic things that have happened to me.
What do you think ghosts see of us? Anything? Do they know we're here?
Well, you know, we were talking about these other hypotheses regarding ghosts, and one idea that I've always found really attractive is that it's just basically a time slip in both directions. So, you know, you hear these stories about entities all the time. I don't care what they are, you know, leprechauns, Bigfoot, ghosts, the visitors. And a lot of times they seem surprised to see us, you know, not all the time, but a lot of times in these stories, they seem surprised to see us. And of course, we're always surprised to see them. So I kind of wonder if in the case of ghosts, that there's not some sort of time slip going on there. And we're seeing what we think is a ghost when in reality, it's a person who's perfectly alive in their timeline, their time period. Whereas, you know, who knows, maybe some of these older stories of visitors from Mars and whatnot are people perceiving time slips from the future. And they're like, why are these people dressed in this way? And what's this tiny little box that they're holding in their hands and things like that?
Annie thought that box was very important. And she always said that she thought that this had something to do with the future. She said to me once that she said, I think your master of the key was from the future. But you know, there's a wonderful movie. It's very obscure. It made sort of a splash at first. It's called A Ghost Story with Rooney Mara. And it's the fun thing about it is the ghosts in the movie are just simply have sheets over their heads. So, you know, there's no effort whatsoever made to, there's no CGI or anything. They're just people walking around with sheets over their heads. But there's some fascinating things in the movie when Rooney Mara begins to, her boyfriend dies and she begins to see these ghosts, and she at one point there's one ghost looking out of a window of another house, and she communicates with the ghost, and when she asks the ghost what he's there for, he says, I'm waiting. And she says, well, for who? And he says, I don't remember.
Yeah, I.
Isn't that wonderful?
It is, and it calls to mind, you know, a lot of my favorite media surrounding these topics. There's always an emotional core to it, you know. I mean, we can talk about big budget blockbusters where aliens are taking over the Earth, or, you know, scary haunted house movies. But the ones that really stick with me are always ones that have, you know, an emotional core to it. I think in regards to, you know, the UFO topic, Arrival was a fantastic film that's really got to that sort of same emotional resonance as Ghost Story, as you were alluding to.
Yeah. Now that emotional resonance, getting back to Ecology of Souls, what Terrence said, I think, is so critical, that we are so alienated from our souls that we can't recognize them. I think that's really important, that we're soul blind. I'm working on a book now called Them, which a lot of it is about the fact that we are soul blind. And yet a lot of it is also about the physicality and alienness of the whole thing. I mean, after all, my own uncle worked on the debris from Roswell, and it was physical. And in fact, it's been understood, and that metal is in use in many different applications in the world now. And I'm hoping that finally that sort of thing will come out, because Ron Moultrie, the Undersecretary of Defense, I believe is for intelligence, said a few weeks ago that we don't have any bodies, we don't have any materials, we don't have any UFOs. And I thought at first I was disgusted. And then I thought, well, he's probably not lying. He probably simply doesn't know. But what do we actually know? Is the world of the dead technologically active, and is it here?
Well, there's a lot to unpack there.
Well, you know. I'm okay. I'm gonna bow out and let you right. Unpack it. Bye bye.
Well, you know, the thing that I love about that Terrence McKenna quote is that it kind of breaks my heart every time I reread it. It just speaks to me on such a visceral level. And I was surprised to find that similar sentiments were echoed by Paul Devereaux in some of his research as well. He once said that he suspected that, you know, these extraterrestrials that we meet sometimes in altered states of consciousness were a part of ourselves. And, you know, if you look at sort of Jungian ideas of the shadow self and some, you know, psychology, some psychological ideas, it does speak to the fact that we've alienated and sort of disregarded aspects of ourselves. And in a lot of those traditions, like, these things, these aspects of ourselves will find a way to make themselves known. And, you know, a lot of volume one is talking about how many soul traditions we've lost along the way. This idea of the wandering soul and polypsychism, as I alluded to earlier. So I do think that we're sort of at a deficit right now. And, you know, I hate to sound like a curmudgeon, but I think that the more and more we indulge this technological fetish, the further and further we get drawn away from these older traditions of soul and being in touch with who we are. I mean, if you take away a lot of people's, maybe myself included, we take away their hobbies and their occupations and their interests and whatnot, they don't really know who they are. And that's a real tragedy that I think we should all spend our lives trying to get acquainted with ourselves. So that's the first part. Now, the second part, regarding, you know, physical crash debris and whatnot, this is something that I've butted heads with a lot of folks over the years with, and I don't think they ever quite caught my meaning. I suspect that there's a strong, perhaps even the most important part of these phenomena are non-physical. But that isn't to say that they can't interact with the physical environment or even leave physical traces. And the example that I always like to use is, you know, ghosts. Ghosts, I think we would all agree, are non-physical, but they slam doors and leave behind footprints. That was an early ghost hunting technique, was to spread out talcum powder and wait for footprints to manifest. So you have the non-physical interacting with the physical. And this is why some people sort of get it confused when you start bringing metaphysics into ufology, because they think that these things are at odds. And the truth is, the non-physical and the physical have never been at odds. It's never been our understanding. It's only really a post-industrial revolution, maybe even post-enlightenment idea that these things ever were at odds. So the fact that you could have something that is, for lack of a better term, a spiritual phenomenon manifesting, you know, bits and bobs strewn across the desert in the American Southwest, I don't see those two things as really being in conflict. And to the contrary, I do think that we have recovered some things that are very much like that. Of course, where I tend to break off from the pack is a lot of people say, well, these are bits of, you know, an alien spacecraft. I'm like, well, maybe, or maybe they should be viewed along the lines of something like, ectoplasm or saints relics or things like that. I mean, even some UFO site debris like angel hair has been very famous for being very physical and then just dematerializing when it's held in a sealed bottle. Now to the final question, which I think is the most interesting one and one that I think speaks very much to your direct experience. Can the afterlife, can the other side, can that have some sort of technical dimension to it? And I would say that it seems like it can. And this is an idea that doesn't sit very well with us nowadays. In our current modern, you know, society, where we think of, you know, oh, you die and you go to be an angel and you float up in the clouds. But in a lot of these older traditions, ancient Egypt, ancient China, some Native American traditions, there was an idea that the afterlife was just like life here. It was a mirror image. And it had a lot of the things that we sort of wake up and have to do every day. You had to wake up and do it every day in the afterlife. And with that comes the implication that there could be technological progress and change. And what surprised me when I was looking into this topic is to find exactly how early this was, how early this appeared in a lot of ufology. You can find conferences, lectures, etc., that were done back in the 1950s, where they're actually entertaining this idea that people who died with significant engineering skills or whatever might not be able to build a craft on the other side that comes over to our side in the form of UFOs. Now, I'm not saying that this is definitely what's happening, but when I heard that, it immediately put me in the mindset of your experiences with Konstantin Radove.
Yeah. Just to remind you folks, we talked about this the last time we were together, and I've talked about it elsewhere, so I'll be very brief. There was someone a year or so ago was interested in having my implant, had a CAT scan done on my implant. And apparently on some level, there was fear that I might agree to have it taken out. And someone appeared here, someone I knew from the other side. It's a complex story, and explained to me what it was, how it, and who designed it. And it was designed, he said, by what man, he pronounced the name Konstantin Radive. And I was perplexed by that, but not so perplexed that I didn't, after the man left, go on the internet and Google the name. And I realized he'd mispronounced his name. The name is Radove, Konstantin Radove, and he was a specialist in his life. He's now deceased and has communicated from the other side. He was a specialist in electronic voice communication techniques and devices on this side of, and apparently is still on the other side. And the interesting thing is the implant has this little, these words that flash past your hip in a slit in my eye. If I'm looking at a very white surface, I can usually see them, like right now and in on the white part of the screen. I can't follow them, but he explained how they worked, and I've been all through all that. We're not going to go down that road today. But the incredible thing is I have only talked to one other person who has this same slit with the words going through it in his eye. He is an expert on Konstantin Radove.
Yeah, that's miraculous.
Isn't it miraculous? And to me, it means this. It means I think I have suggestive evidence. I wouldn't say it's definite evidence, but suggestive evidence that there is an other world, and it is the world of the dead, and they are trying to project into this world using technology. But go ahead.
Oh no, I was just going to say I didn't mean to sort of for us to retread familiar ground, but I love how well that experience of yours sums up this idea of technological progress on the other side,
right?
And interestingly enough, you know, if you look in some of the, for whatever reason, the former Eastern Bloc and Russia and Latin America always have some of the wildest UFO contact experience cases. I've spoken to friends in both those parts of the world. And they're like, yeah, our stories are wild over here. I don't know why. But in a couple of those stories, especially from these former Soviet states, you'll find people who not only encounter the dead aboard the craft, but they are made... It's made very clear that the dead aboard the craft have duties that they have to do. And in one example that I love, someone was aboard the craft, and they actually saw a dead neighbor walking by with like building supplies and walking to a different part to engage in a construction project. And I think that again also sums up very well this idea of technological progress continuing on the other side.
Yeah, I think that this there's a kind of breathing between two realities, and we move back and forth. Does that mean we never leave this process? We never die? That when we die in one, we're then born again in the other, and we go back and forth, back and forth? What does it mean, Joshua?
I suspect you might be onto something. I know that you've played with that idea before of our world actually being Sheol, right?
And this being the world of
yes,
the dead. Yeah.
Yes, sir. And interestingly enough, if you look at some of the Western European fairy lore, there are indications that they would laugh at funerals and cry at births, which also seems to suggest that there is this reciprocal nature between whatever other world, you know, the fairyland and the afterlife were not necessarily one and the same, but they bear a lot of similarities. There seems to be some sort of give and take between these worlds that does imply, I would argue, basically a revolving door between realities.
Yeah, there's also, isn't there an implication somewhere that you grow younger in the other world until you're reborn here, and then older in this world until you die, and then in other words, it works like that. And so that everyone in the other world is slowly getting younger and younger.
The sort of cyclicality, I'm trying to think. I think I've stumbled upon that. The thing that sticks out in my mind is that, especially in, again, because I tend to focus on a lot of this Western European fairy folklore, there was sort of an equalizing effect where a lot of people who passed away, if they were younger than 33, they would age up to 33, and if they were older than 33, that age down to 33, approximately the age that Christ was crucified. Obviously, there's some Christianization going on in that concept, but you know, I think that you're onto something with that idea as well, because if you look at some of this subset of stories that you find throughout Europe. Of the midwife to the fairies, where some individual, some mysterious individual, oftentimes a rider and cloaked in black, will show up to a young lady's door and demand that she come with him, and he ends up taking her to what is revealed to be a fairy dwelling, and there's a fairy woman who is in labor. Sometimes it's a dead woman that the midwife knows, and she is commanded to bring that fairy child into being. So you take that idea of human fairies into existence in those older legends, and then you look at some of these stories of fairies serving as psychopomps, as these characters who escort people from our world into the afterlife. Not Joshua, strongly indicated, but it's there.
Can you define the word psychopomp just quickly for the listeners?
Yes. Psychopomps are any sort of character. It could be an animal, it could be natural phenomena, it could be a deity, it could be a folk figure that escorts the living to the world of the dead. So characters like the Grim Reaper, Anubis, Christ or God for the Christians, Hermes for the Greeks. These are all different characters, and also animals like birds and dogs and horses. There are some indications that fairies sometimes fulfill that psychopomp role in some of the older mythology. It's not entirely clear, but there are definitely some suggestions. I mean, Gwynep Nudd was a Welsh psychopomp who was made into the king of the fairies. So there seems to be a relationship with that. So I think there's an interesting parsimony between the human midwife bringing the fairy child into existence and the fairy psychopomps taking the elderly humans out of existence. It again sort of reinforces that idea of there being this reciprocal nature between our world and the other world. The breathing, as you said.
Right. Now, the ancient Egyptians' religion had an aim. That aim was ascension, a return to the stars, specifically, I believe, the constellation of Orion. And the pyramid texts are all sets of instructions for the pharaohs about how to do this. In other words, it's not about a reciprocal movement between two universes. It's about getting off the treadmill altogether. Is this reciprocity something that's just natural and inevitable? Or is there a possibility that there are other things that can happen to a soul after we die, as in ascension off of this whole wheel, of, as it were?
Well, you know, it's interesting that you mentioned the Egyptians, because you sort of had to thread that needle's eye of mediocrity in a way, because, yeah, you might ascend, but if you were too bad, your heart and your soul might get devoured by Ammit, the soul devourer, the demoness who was partially a hippopotamus and lion. So an indication across a lot of these different spiritualities that you can break free of the wheel. You know, that's definitely the goal of a lot of Eastern traditions. You know, it's maybe I'm being a contrarian, but sometimes I just find that idea kind of saddens me a little bit. I've got a lot of sad moments today, I guess, but I just think that there's so much beauty in the world that it might be kind of nice to keep coming back. Of course, you know, I don't know the beauties of ascension, so maybe there's something to it. But you do see the sort of reincarnative aspect across these older traditions, often symbolized as a wheel. And there are indications that you can get off at some point. Interestingly enough, with regards to UFOs, so many stories, a lot of the back half of Ecology of Souls Volume 2 is tying into these ideas of reincarnation. People who say that, you know, in a past life, they were an extraterrestrial. Or people who say that the extraterrestrials revealed to them the mysteries of their previous past lives here on Earth. And then when you combine that in with all this talk that I've had over two books worth of the connection between these phenomena and the dead, and then this obsession that they have with birth as well, it seems like really, in a lot of ways, Ecology of Souls should have been retitled A New Mythology of Reincarnation, or Death and Birth in the Paranormal. But, you know, I do think there are other things that could happen to souls more sinisterly. You know, I mentioned Ammit, the soul devourer, which again, soul devouring is something that you talked about at length as one of your concerns in transformation. I believe it's Nigel Kerner was a researcher who believed that the gray aliens' primary goal was to harvest souls that didn't make it into the light, but actually ended up falling over the edge. And that was one of their primary motivations. He believed that the small visitors were some sort of drone that lacked that essential spark of life that their creators had failed to imbue them with. And that's another chilling prospect. You know, I mean, that's the thing that you find when you write a book about death and the paranormal, is you end up going, you know, death's not so bad. There are things a lot worse than death. If any of this stuff is true, there are things worse than death that can happen to you.
A couple of weeks ago, we had the two authors, people who were very close to Nigel, who's passed away, on the show discussing the book and this idea of a machine that might be attempting to either create its own soul or gather souls from us. I want to go now to another subject, which again goes back to the whole physical aspect of things. We're going to talk about hybrids in a few minutes in the third half hour, but right now I want to lead into that by talking about this business of taking of sexual material. To me, this is an absolute certainty because it happened to me. And so when I hear stories of women having eggs and fetuses stolen and guys having semen taken, I think they're true. And I think they're true because I lived this. Now, what is going on here in relation to the cosmology and the way the whole phenomenon intersects reality as you understand them?
Well, you know, there's some superficial comparisons that you can make right away that I'm sure you and the audience are familiar with, these older ideas of incubi and succubi, who might awaken their victims in the middle of the night to harvest these things from folks. But I suspect that this is a way to reinforce the role that these things have in our lives. And this is where I get into quite a bit of speculation, but I try to be quite clear in the book that it is purely speculation on my part. I suspect that these, in some cases, because it's hard to say everything, right? In some cases, I suspect that these entities, the visitors perhaps, might be stewards of reincarnation. We recycle souls, as you so elegantly put it. Water bearers from the well of souls, I think, is some of the phraseology that I like to use. And because of that, they are intimately involved with the creation of new life. And again, it's an odd idea, but I kind of wonder if some of these experiences, you know, you hear these stories about people going and seeing these jars and jars and rows of human-alien hybrids and containers. Sometimes I wonder if that's not literally the afterlife factory where all of our souls are minted. It's an odd idea. I spend a lot of time trying to back up that concept. But, you know, there is something to it. Sometimes I wonder, and this isn't to detract from people who have their gametes harvested, but sometimes I wonder if it's not part of this bigger theatrical agenda that we see. I mean, the example that I always like to use is that one of my main arguments against the extraterrestrial hypothesis is that we have such sophisticated means of collecting DNA on our own planet, non-invasive techniques. And yet in a lot of these narratives, you see the UFO occupants like breaking out comically large buzz saws and giant syringes and things like that that seem really quite barbaric compared to what we can do here on Earth. I mean, you know, I can collect DNA with a Q-tip and go down to CVS and get a DNA test, right? Or something like that. So to me, there does seem to be some sort of warranting of emotion that's involved. So I wonder sometimes if it isn't the literal reproductive material that is the important part of that harvesting process, and if it's not all the emotion that's attached to it. And there does seem to be some emotional component, especially when you look to later things like the baby presentations, you know, scenario where mothers are given their human hybrid babies, and the babies seem to take nourishment from the human emotion, only human emotion, without any actual, you know, milk being provided.
And yet the babies are in your arms for such a short time. That happened to me and Anne. We had a presentation too. A few months after the sex thing, it was 6 or 7 months after that. So it happens. But you know, the babies are in this world,
right? And again, it's that skirting of the boundary between physical and non-physical. It's one of the most confounding things about this phenomena for me.
Me too.
And
All of us.
But I can't help but feel like, Whitley, I can't help but feel like part of the reason we have such a tough time with it is that we've been gaslit by our culture into thinking that things like emotions are just chemical reactions in our brains. I mean, that obviously plays a role, but I think that a lot of these things have a more objective reality than we've been led to believe by our current culture.
You know, the reason we have such a huge death cult in Western culture, you know what our death cult is? It's the hospital system and medicine that does everything possible. It's devoted entirely to keeping people alive. It's a little less so now, but I mean, when Annie decided to pass that she was finished, all of the caregivers were just blew up in our faces and went rushing off into the distance in tears. And I thought to myself, this is a culture that is fighting death. It's fighting death. We're afraid of death. And is it that we are afraid of death because we have lost track of the fact that we are not, that we are living right now while in the body, also at in another level, that this body is a machine that we are using to move through time and gather experience, but it is not all of us.
I think that's incredibly prescient. I mean, we used to have to deal with death in a very much more personal way. Not even that long ago, you know, in terms of our you know, current situation. And I do think a lot of that fear does stem from the fact that we've been force-fed a lot of distractions and nihilism, to be quite frank with you. And that's sort of what I was getting at when I said that, you know, you end up writing, when you spend so much time looking at death as I have over the course of writing these books, you start to say death isn't that bad of a thing. Like, you know, and that's, you know, that's part of the reason that so many people are frightened of these things, you know, whether it's cryptids or ghosts or, you know, UFOs, they're always thinking that death is the worst thing that could happen to them. And I'm like, you know, that's not really, I mean, I think, you know, I mean, even here in this life, there are things worse than death, you know, hurting a loved one irreparably, you know, that's something that I would much rather die than have that happen.
Yeah.
So, you know, I think that a readjustment is necessary. And you're right. There's this, it's almost like a cult of life more than a cult of death.
Right.
Yeah. This, you know, preserve life at all costs. And I know that sounds callous, and I'm sure people could take that out of context. But what I mean by that is that there isn't a consideration of whether or not there are greater forces that sometimes have decided it's time for people to go. And I think a resignation and an awareness of that is the compassionate thing to do.
Well, exactly. And I think also being facing it squarely like Annie did, Whitley, this is it. I'm going. I'm finished here. And it hit me right in the heart. But she did it her way, and she did it right, and she wasn't afraid of it. Now, we have reached the end of the first hour, so we're going to go on down the road. And I would like to thank those of you listening on the free side so much for being part of Dreamland, and I would urge you to consider doing more, because we have video conferences. You could probably actually talk to Joshua and ask him your questions personally if he comes into our video conference room, which I suspect he may. And it's so much going on. There's a wonderful, warm group of people on unknowncountry.com talking together, and there's no fake news. There's no trolls. It's not anything like that. It's a place worth being. Thank you anyway, and we'll see you again next week.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by unknowncountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.